Among the many epic battles and exciting adventures told across the Star Wars universe, we've enjoyed so many characters and their stories since May 25th, 1977. On that momentous date, we were introduced to characters like Luke Skywalker, Princess Leia, and Han Solo. And in the years that followed, we would meet so many new friends, like Lando Calrissian, and some of you probably also like the Ewoks and even Jabba the Hutt. From among all those incredible tales and thrilling escapades, one great hero stood shining golden above them all! Now, let us revisit some of his greatest triumphs and most unfortunate misadventures.
Until the first day of the convention, the rain. So anybody who was there, anybody was there, there's a phrase I think in Shakespeare, it's going to be a very educational sermon. I'm going to use words like Shakespeare. Look at that. Henry V, he talks about St. Crispin's Day. The soldiers are such a tough being that anybody who's there on St. Crispin's Day or Wings Over the Rockies is my brother. We suffer. But all these questions you have, of course, can immediately be answered by purchasing my book. I don't know if we can do a close up here. Can we do a close up? Yes, I am C-3PO, the inside story. Oh, yes. I wanted to call it Telling the Odds. Yeah, one, don't forget, what's your name? What? Brian. Brian understands what Telling the Odds is about. Brian, yeah, just come here for a minute. Where are you? Come, look at it quickly. You know, you're very short. Oh, no, no. I'm going to say that. You are from Denver, aren't you? Yes. Okay. You look taller now. It's going to be a very tough morning. Brian? Ryan? Okay, we'll do diction classes afterwards, right? Now, what was the question? Oh, yes. Why was it a good title, Telling the Odds?
Because when they were flying into the asteroid field, he's like, what are the odds of surviving an asteroid field? And he started telling them what, I forget what the numbers were. And then,
that's how I know. Well, I don't, this is a proof of
that we never remember. I'm sorry, I'm not normally on stage.
And then, also, you should have a great career. So there we are, in the Millennium Falcon.
And then he interrupts you and said, never tell me the odds.
Who said that?
Han Solo.
Very good. Anybody? Very good. Thank you. Right. In case you haven't heard, I have written a book. It's also on CD. Something like 12 hours of me reading my own words. Do you know how difficult that was? Jesus, I talk rubbish. Brian, may I give you a small gift? So, here it is. I don't want to be nervous. Who here has a question of asking somebody who's written a book? And you go there, bring your book. Oh, beautiful young lady, will you come up here? She's not wearing a Star Wars costume, don't say anything. The Lord of the Rings. Anyway, yes, what's your name?
Molly.
Just look over there, Molly, and wave to your mother. There she is. Hello, Molly. How are you? Good. What's your question? Yeah. Speaking to that's good.
I was just curious what your favorite Star Wars movie to be in and what your favorite scene was.
You was curious what my favorite Star Wars movie. Well, I have to be saying that. Because this is not the Star Wars convention, is there anybody in this theatre who's not seen a Star Wars film? Anyway? You see, who you would be sitting over there, wouldn't you? Right. Do you know how old I am? Who hasn't seen the Star Wars movie? You're all pointing at somebody. Where? Stand up. Come here. Come on. Well, when you're ready. Yeah, well, we'll just wait. Come here. Come stand here. What's your name?
Adam.
And you haven't seen a Star Wars movie?
No, I haven't.
This is incredible. Why haven't you?
I just haven't watched it.
What have you been doing that you can tell us that you have been doing other than watching to say hello to the Ring Toms.
But now, so I've got the neck on,
And now they came at me with, imagine an Easter egg, a head, two pieces. It was made of fiberglass, not chocolate, sadly. Because believing in that heat, it would have been a disaster. So they chose to make it a plastic, okay. And the front and the back. And now I was losing my connection with humanity, with the world. But what I would hear was great scrabbling sounds as they tried to put on little hearing things here and here. And every sound they made, plaster on plastic, aluminum on plastic, and amplified my head along with sounds from down here. And then they said, it's not going in. And there were three holes that had to go in. And the third hole moved away every time they came near it. So I, and then somebody put back, and then they did the other side. And then finally, that bit worked really well. And so suddenly, for the first time, after my 15 minutes tryout in the studio in London, I was dressed as three people. It was horrible. I lost every bodily sensation apart from pain, which was kind of all over. And then, and I've described this before, because this, Molly was it, said what was my best moment in Star Wars? Because it was in a tent and they pulled back the flaps of the tent. And I could see the desert out there and I kind of inched forward because I was having to find a new body. I didn't know what was happening around me. I could see straight ahead, like that. Couldn't see down here, couldn't see here. I inched out and now I was out on the sand. And the sand crawler was over there, but between us, there was an American crew and a British crew and a lot of local helpers from villages around. And nobody had ever seen anything like this before. And the sun was rising there, I remember, because I could feel it hitting the gold suit, obviously reflecting a lot of it, but instantly the heat was coming in. And I kind of sensed that I looked pretty amazing. Except it wasn't me that looked amazing, was it? It was the suit. But I still could see people. And the Americans, they were pointing, they go, oh my God, that's incredible, I haven't seen this, it's incredible, fantastic. And the British crew in the middle, because I knew the dynamic, even better, the Tunisian helpers, Not until the Ewoks did I have such a reception as that. And I was actually enjoying the glory, if you will. And then one of the assistant directors said, yeah, okay, come over. And within two strides, the costume had broken. And it was like, it was like you're going on a posh date and the elastic goes. And you think, I don't feel kind of like really going out, you know. It's like, so we kind of wobbled there, this is the set. And from that moment, we chucked some plastic padding up this leg. And here's the thing that I learned from filmmaking, it's kind of obvious when you think about it. What the camera doesn't look at, you, my friends, do not see. And when the camera could drop down, you would have seen the plastic wadding up here. But it didn't help my sense of dignity, you know. But we got through that scene. And then, of course, lunch. If you start about 7 o'clock when the sun comes up, because you're there to use the sunlight, it's free. Obviously, the airfare is a bit of a thing there. You get free sunshine, which is going to go down at 7 o'clock in the evening. So you can work very quick. But of course, film unions dictate you must have a hot meal cold, a hot meal and cold meal choice for lunch. British crews, well, even in the desert, roast beef, potatoes. And so they blew a whistle and everybody ran away. And my dresser, Maxie, came up and stood in front of me because I could only see straight ahead. And in fact, the moment I got outside the sand crawler to come back for a moment, I thought, I didn't know who I am. And I asked the continuity lady, and she sensed that I was saying, could you please take a Polaroid picture and hold it up so that I can see what I look like, who I'm playing today? And she did exactly that. She stood in front of it. And then, when it developed, she stood, and I had to move, so I can't stay where it was, but I had to line up my eyes, and I looked at 3 years, a living face for the first time. And I kind of absorbed it, and then went away. And we all know what happened next. George said, action. What an enthusiasm. He was exhausted, but he spent years trying to get this film on the road, and already disasters had happened. Sets were blown down by the weather, the sand was getting all the equipment, and it was a disaster. And now he had this very British actor who was going to create one of Hollywood's greatest legends. So he said, action. And I'm sure it's in the story's in the doorway. Did I tell you? You can hear it read in my voice on the CD available here today and on whatever it's called, Audible. So he said, action. And it was a point where Uncle Owen came out and said, you speak the voice now, mind your language and moisturizer is. Freaky Owen had to say, why, set is my primary function. Is that what it said? Anybody got the book here? I asked the engineers to go back through to this existing game, but whatever. And I actually couldn't say the words. I was so confused by being in this carapace, this suit of armor that didn't fit. It was like it was made for a small person. With no vision, poor hearing, except every time I moved, all that sound came up into my head. And I couldn't speak. Cut, says George. And we try again, go back to number one, which is the beginning. Action. You speak the binary language, the voice of paper, battery. My sense, that is second language. And cut. The third time I got it wrong. And I was so embarrassed. I was used to being, you didn't get things wrong on stage or television. You just knew the words. And generally, they were a lot more intelligible than moist evaporators and binary load lifters. It was a new word to me. The third time I got it wrong, he came up to me and looked at me with such fury and said, don't worry about the voice switch. Fix it later. You see anything you want. Went back to his number one action. My first job was. Terrific. And he used to get so angry with me because often in the tape, one of the last things they did was the eyes, and they had a little switch here, and there was a battery pack of six, whatever the battery was, and a little tiny switch, and the lights would go on, and I could see a kind of thing around me. And I could see right through the middle. But often, after a cut, he would walk up and go, his eyes went out. With such hatred, it's anger. It wasn't my fault. Better batteries. Remember the bunny, whatever it was, the energy bunny, they couldn't afford those in those days. And of course, years later, I felt like I was on fire, something I mean, beyond heat, beyond whatever. Ow, ow, ow. And eventually, one of my assistants came over, opened the battery pack to find out the wires had shorted. And I was getting cooked. I was like a 4th of July barbecue in there, because it was not good. So that was day one. Where was the government? I can't remember. Has anybody got a question? Who's got a question? Yeah. Yeah. And of course, to finish the story about the voice, I did call it. I was very unintelligible. But what it gave me is a guide track. Because then we're going to edit the physical scenes with the audio. And one reason you have a clapper board is you can tell when the film, when that hits that and you click, now the whole thing's in sync. Okay? It's all changed now, but they still mark it with a DigiSync, which is the electronic version. So they needed, you know, voice if you couldn't use it. And it didn't sound good because I had a microphone here. And if you imagine putting a waste paper basket over your head and then shoving a transmitter here, obviously the effect isn't going to be so good. 6 months later, a phone call to America. Would I go to Hollywood to put my voice on the finished film? I actually forgot about the film. seriously, it wasn't a great experience. So I put it out of my mind. Anyway, I got to Hollywood. I get into the sound producer's stage. I'm done with theatre. Big control, very exciting. And the guy says, oh, hi, Anthony. I didn't like the way he said my name. He said, Anthony. Yeah, Anthony, you know. That's incredible we got here, because you know, we spent a couple of months trying to find a voice for the character, because you know George really hates you, but oh, hi, George. You hated my performance? No, I never thought of it being a British problem. And you could have said something, I would have done it differently. So I spent 3 days with Jack and I, putting my voice back on the finished film. And you know, that's Hollywood. And remember, you know, I'm talking to you all the time out of my heart. So, who wants a chance with a brilliant question to gain an audio book? No, don't be desperate, very good. Okay, and then we walk them up to let us come here. Yes, the mask is very beautiful. Would you stand up and just look this way? And I'm going to give you that microphone. There we are. What is your question?
Well, what was it like to work with Sir Alec Guinness? And my real question is, should it be Sir Anthony Daniels?
But your question was, what was my favorite scene, wasn't it? Yeah. I do have a favorite scene, but it's a bit naughty. It was in episode 4, and you'll remember, it was episode 4, and it's where Luke is in the garage. I got stuck, you know, this oil bath is going to feel so good, do you know that? Adam? It's a brilliant scene. When you watch Star Wars, you will see it is absolutely sound. Because there was three people in the garage, and I was actually on a platform, a kind of elevator. And as I talked, you watch that scene and go, they press the elevator button, and down we go and go. And it was actually vegetable oil, dyed green. And very nicely, it being, I think, March and quite cold for the time of year in England, that would change. Woof. It became the hottest summer in history. And I was dressed like this. But now, my feet are in vegetable oil. Yeah. Do not try this at home. Well, some of you don't try. And as I went down, the suit was very tight, and the oil was coming up on the outside. And they had warmed it. It felt quite, you know, kind of weird, because as it came up to here on the outside, it was down around my ankles. And as the scene progressed and I stayed in oil, gradually the oil came up on the inside, green and warm. And at a certain point in the conversation with Luke Skywalker, you can see three people go. But worse was to follow. Worse was to follow. If you again watch that scene, Luke Skywalker, Mark Hamill, adorable. Hands for Mark Hamill. He hands 3PO a towel. Now, if you watch, he's very careful because my hands didn't work. I had no grip, anything like that. And he puts it in 3PO's hand, and I kind of clench it. And then for the rest of the scene, because I was so disconnected from my body in reality, that I was doing drying myself after an oil bath and acting. And I could have dried myself up here, except the arm really doesn't go that near. So I was drying myself down here. All through the scene. And it's meant to be a family affair. Sorry about that. On the other hand, talking about Sir Alec, absolutely adorable. And in fact, he saved my sanity. He said to me one day, no, filmmaking. Filmmaking isn't always like this. You're hearing other better rooms. But actually, I adored him from day one when we met on the airplane going to Tunisia, because we got to him. And as we got out, he got into his limo and I was heading for the bus, the crew bus. Believe me, I already knew my place. And he got out of his vehicle and said, pardon me, sir, have I given you your perfume?
Yes.
But I've never been in a film or in anything, really. And I said, your pocket money. Because they seem to have never been in a lot. And I said, you should have some. Adorable man. So, and it got better from that. So he saved me. And so it was a lovely memory. May I award you available on whatever. Yeah, there's lots more stories, but they are giving me the warning sign that our time together is over, at least for now. So this is the bit where I kind of get sad and mournful and whatever. Really? That ruined that moment, didn't it? That so ruined that little bit of tragedy. You've had to cackle and laugh. What's your name? What? Asha, come here. When you just faster, come on, move it. That's money. They're giving the thing. They're giving me four fingers. They're about to give me two, and then you know the next one. Okay. So before we get that final finger, just because you're new. Okay. Seriously, it's been a weird time for us lately in the last few years. And this is, we're getting back to normal now and all that kind of thing. But one of the things I really enjoy about all the Star Wars fan clubs, the 501st, the people who even like Lord of the Rings and who love hobbits and elves and all that kind of orcs and dwarfs and dwarfs. Come here. You laughed, didn't you? Explain to me why you laughed. Stand up. Again, it's too rude. I was going through orcs and running through the alphabet there. One of the things I love about Comic Cons and all that kind of thing is that you come together in innocence and joy and companionship and friendship, and you make friends and memories. And I'm very touched that so many people come up and talk to me at my desk. Tell me how important Star Wars was to their childhood. People of a certain age who are here. It did become a seminal part of their lives, their family lives. And now many people maybe are not around anymore. And it became important to people who need comfort in this world, who need to escapism. Not all the time, just occasionally, to feel that the character on screen is portraying their feelings. Three people, particularly the people who are insensitive, who are afraid to say they're afraid. Three people was never afraid to say he was afraid. So it's a two-way thing. I started by saying I was alone on stage. I haven't felt alone for a minute. And that's because of you and your love and your warmth. And I'm going to give you a false hug.